biggest problem in the world of education has actually been hiding in plain sight. And solving this problem has become my own personal journey of redemption. So in 1999, I was the director of operations for school construction in New York City. It was the largest school construction program in the whole world. We spent an average of a billion dollars every year for 10 years. We built 100 new schools and renovated 600 schools. So you can imagine my consternation when I realized that all of that expenditure on school construction had not improved education outcomes at all. Student achievement hadn't improved at all, $10 billion later. So I saw my career kind of going up in flames, and I said, I have to do something different with my life. And my wife said, hey, start a consulting company. She said that there has to be a market in the world for an architect who wants to design schools according to the research about how children actually learn, as opposed to this mental model we carry around for what a school is supposed to look like. So I did. I started my consulting company. It was in a two-bedroom walk-up in Queens, New York. And I had three children, a cat, and of course my wife was laid off around the same time, so this was not the most auspicious way to begin what I had hoped would be a journey, not just of redemption, but actually to transform education worldwide. I set the bar pretty high. I didn't want to just build nice school buildings, I wanted to transform education. So this is the apartment building in which we started that journey. So we have $2 trillion worth of obsolete school buildings just here in the United States alone. And that number is much bigger worldwide. So these school buildings are based on this model called cells and bells. It's a very antiquated model. Students start their school day in a cell called a classroom. The bell goes off, and they move to another identical cell. This classroom-based model of education began between 1875 and 1925, believe it or not. And even if you could rationalize that it makes sense at the turn of the last century, certainly I think you'd have a hard time saying why it makes sense today. Imagine this, you take a group of students, you sort them by age, you put them on cheap plastic chairs, you have them sitting with an adult who directs their learning, and then you give them less square feet per student than you give a prisoner in a high security prison. That's absolutely true. So clearly, if you want to reconcile this with the skills that we say students need to develop, think in terms of global awareness, for example, or empathy, or creativity, or problem solving, and on and on and on, technological literacy, working in interdisciplinary groups. Clearly, this model doesn't work. So the classroom is obsolete. You can take this to the bank, because I know this, the classroom is obsolete. So if the classroom is obsolete, we need to go to another model. We need to go away to a different model, and we call it the learning community model. But we can't throw away $2 trillion worth of architecture that we already have out there. What do we do with them? Well, here's how you do it. You take a cells and bells design, which is good for lectures. You have classrooms oriented along a double-loaded corridor. You get rid of all the dysfunctional furniture to start with, and you get rid of as many of the walls as you can get rid of as you can to create a variety of room sizes and shapes. You also create some outdoor connections. The idea is to spend as little money as possible so you don't impact the structure. And now you've captured the space in the hallway and you've created a space for 150 students and about 7 or 8 teachers. Now you've created something called a small learning community. In this small learning community, you can do education differently. All 150 students can either gather together or that space can be used for collaboration. Classroom type spaces still exist, except we call them learning studios because they're much more agile than classrooms. Now those learning studios can combine to create what we call learning suites. Teachers can teach as a team in learning suites. Two teachers can work together. And then we have these garage doors that open up and connect the learning suites to the common space outside. So now you have a variety of teaching and learning modalities possible that would never have happened in the typical classroom. So here's what a cells and bells model might look like. This is from the International School of Brussels. And over one summer, we converted it to look like this. Now this feels more like a Starbucks, the kind of place that high school students actually want to be in. The school loved it so much that they went ahead and built a new high school that we designed, which has now been in operation for 4 years. And ISB is one of the top IB schools in the world. So learning communities are far superior to classrooms for a multiplicity of reasons, and here are some. Classrooms teachers teach in isolation. Whereas in the learning community, teachers teach as a team, they collaborate. So the teacher-student ratio is variable in the learning community. And when teachers teach as a team, guess what? Student learning improves dramatically. Classrooms are very inefficient. You waste 30% of the space in hallways. Whereas learning communities, we capture all of that space for teaching and learning. That means it's cheaper, it's faster, and it's better for learning. So what's wrong with the learning community? Classrooms are not happy places. Why would a child want to be trapped for several years of their life in a box? Whereas learning communities are designed right from the ground up to connect and reconnect children with their natural joy of learning. Daniel Pink said it well, schools should be about our children's future and not about our past. Classrooms are about our past, whereas learning communities are about our children's future. A teacher friend of mine put this well. He said, teaching in a classroom is like trying to push Jell-O up the stairs. Whereas teaching in a learning community, pushing Jell-O down the stairs. So all my teacher friends and colleagues, I'm sure they'll agree, they're tired of pushing Jell-O up the stairs and they'd rather stop doing it. That's what teaching in a classroom feels like. So how do you transform education? It's not easy, obviously, because education is a complex system. It's made up of multiple disciplines. So if you mess with one discipline, you mess with everything. There's actually a saying, never before in the history of the United States have we better educated children for the industrial age than we do today. Hey, we've taken 100 years to perfect that model, haven't we? So if I take teachers and students out of the learning classrooms and put them into learning community, guess what? I have to deal with curriculum, I have to deal with teacher professional development, schedules, assessment, everything begins to get messed up. Look at this architectural metaphor. If I take out the foundation of a building, guess what? I have to construct the whole building. So the classroom is the foundation of the education system. If I mess with classrooms, I have no choice but to re-engineer their entire system. So in that sense, the learning community is the quintessential disruptive innovator in education, because with learning communities, teaching goes from being teacher-directed to student-directed. The curriculum goes from being subject-based to interdisciplinary and project-based. And the learning environment goes from being very anonymous and institutional, a place that nobody wants to be, to caring, loving, and community-centered. Now, clients all around the world absolutely love this because it's all about changing the whole system. You can't break something that's fundamentally broken. So we work with teachers, we work with students, and we want teachers in particular to be the architects of their own future. So though they might have some concerns, well, this is going to be very noisy. How do I as a teacher adapt to this new way of learning and teaching? They come around because they realize this is about changing education in a way that will positively impact the lives of hundreds, if not thousands, of children. So going back to that story, starting in that apartment that I was in Queens, New York, it was a great thing that I had my children with me, because looking at them every day reminded me why this journey that I was on was so, so important. My wife was also a great source of support, and guess what? Even my cat pitched in. She tried to keep the roach population in the apartment under control. Though I can tell you this, New York City roaches, they can't really be controlled. They're like kind of like the insect mafia, actually. So this is where we are now. Our practice has actually expanded to 47 countries on 6 continents. Very early on in my journey, I met my partner, Randy, who was also my best friend. He was himself a world-renowned architect. And together, we've hired this absolutely amazing team of architects, engineers, educators, managers. And we've also had the privilege of working with courageous clients who've been willing to push the boundaries of innovation to do what's absolutely the best thing for children. We've worked in some of the most impoverished and poor communities all around the world, but we've also done work for some of the richest and most exclusive private schools. We're doing work with public school districts in Canada and the United States. One of our clients is Boulder Valley School District. They are leveraging a $575 million school construction program to educationally benefit each and every one of their 31,000 students. So this is the Greenville Steam Middle School in South Carolina. It won the MacConnell Award, which is the highest honor worldwide for school design. It means that this model has been vindicated by the mainstream education establishment. This was done in partnership with the local architect. STEAM stands for Science, Technology, Engineering, Art, and Mathematics. As you can see, this doesn't look like what you might expect a typical public school to look like. Certainly not your grandfather's school, and certainly not based on the cells and bells model. So I want to conclude here with this case study. This is the Anne Frank Inspire Academy. It's in San Antonio, Texas. Bruce Rockstrop is the superintendent of the Inspire Academies, and he wants to create 100 of these. Now, this is a public charter school. So we started with just this grain of an idea and organically developed what turned out to be this magnificent gem of a school. So we are very proud of having done work with Bruce, and we walked through the site with him. I was on this walk and finally ended up at the treehouse. Now, I think everybody will agree here that every beautiful school deserves a beautiful treehouse. So while we were there, I was reminiscing about my own life journey and the parallels, starting with nothing, starting with absolutely no experience in the private sector, starting with not a day knowing how to run a business, and here I was, well on my way towards realizing my dream. Meeting my partner Randy, for example, having these great clients doing work with us, recruiting this absolutely amazing team of people all around the world to work with us. All of this couldn't possibly just have happened by accident, could it? So I asked Bruce that question. I said, hey Bruce, do you think there was some kind of divine intervention here, or do you think this was just an accident? And Bruce said, no, there are no accidents in life. And he shared this with me. He said, at the moment of commitment, the entire universe conspires to assist you. I truly believe that has happened in my case, and Bruce said it happened to him as well. So the message I would leave you with, I urge each of you, for those of you, particularly in the world of education, don't give up on it. About 98% of the world still does education in the old cells and bells way. So we still have a long way to go, but certainly if a washed up bureaucrat from New York City can do it, certainly everybody can do it. So those of you who have your own ambitions, your own dreams that you might be putting on the back burner, act on it, commit to it, because when you truly commit to it, the entire universe will conspire to assist you as well, regardless of whether your journey is one of redemption like mine was, or one of discovery, or maybe even one of adventure. So go forth bravely. Thank you.